you're gonna walk the talk and talk the walk. You're gonna walk the talk and talk the walk. You're gonna walk the talk and talk. My brothers and my sisters. You're gonna walk the talk and talk the walk. You're gonna walk the talk and talk the walk. You're gonna walk the talk.
Radio Network and the first episode of Walking the Talk with Kurt. So here we are on Saturday the 19th of April and Sunday the 20th of April, wherever you are in the world, depending on where you are in the world. And so welcome, this is Jerry Jones, and as usual I have my soul sister Sheila Folger.
Good evening to you, my sister Jerry, as we're both in the evening mood. I hope everybody's ready to walk their talk.
Yes, because here he is, the man himself, Mr. Curtis Kallenbach. Welcome. Yay!
I was actually clapping for myself. At that
well,
point,
you were right to be. So, here we are. This is going to be a good bit of talking here.
I was doing a call last night, and it's funny, to do a call by myself is a real pain in the butt. Because it's just me rambling for a couple of hours, and I had a heckler last night, which
Uh-oh.
was very, very bad taste on his part, but I think I know who it was. But it's just kind of sad. But what I was saying to everybody last night was how fun it is to talk to you ladies, because you make things so easy for me.
Oh, well, thank you very much.
It's so easy.
Cool. Well, that's what we're here for, to kind of accommodate and spread the word. That's what it's all about, getting all this information out there. So.
Don't speak too soon.
Yeah, you're chopped off.
So whatever you guys, whatever direction you want to take this, I'll just, you know, we can do what we did last time, and I'll just run with whatever direction you point me in.
Yeah.
Do you want to start with, because I put the link in the chat room to the pictures you sent us. They're up on our website. Yes. Do you want to start off with that, Kurt?
Well, yeah, why not? That's a good place to start anyway. It's an interesting picture, isn't it?
Yes, it is,
and I was just having a discussion about it's interesting because I never gave my daughter a middle name, and I don't know why I didn't do that at the time. So if you could explain the difference between the middle name and the first name.
Well, here's the thing, is that's a picture from a 1973 film, The Exorcist.
Oh, wow.
And wow. what it is, that's the scene right before the Jesuit priest walks into Reagan's room, the girl that's possessed. Right before he walks into her room, he calls the mother over and says, What is your daughter's middle name, Mrs. McNeil?
I didn't remember that. You know, Kurt, that movie, I must have been about 18 at the time, I think, and I actually walked out halfway through the film. I love horror films. Well, I did then, but that scared the life out of me.
Well, what I'm about to explain tonight is going to put the life back into you, because that middle name, or the middle ground, the keystone, whatever you want to call the middle name, that is the thing that gives your life, it allows the Catholic Church to possess your life. It's the middle name. So for those people that don't have a middle name, they're in a better position, but not really, because if you're born without one, or if your parents don't give you one, they're more than happy to put a spacer in between there. So yeah, they give you a middle name whether you get one or not. That is the name of the beast. That in my case, Curtis Richard Kallenbach is identifying the golem, the beast. And so when the priest goes into that bedroom and is going to exorcise or pull the beast out of that girl, he has to know the beast's full name. And in her case, it's all three names. It's first, middle, last, in that order.
And you know what, Kerr? I went to Catholic convent school until I was 11. And the nuns there were very, very upset that I didn't have, that neither of my first two names were saints' names. Isn't that weird?
Well, the middle name is considered, it's not so much the middle name. The middle name is the position that the baptismal name has taken. And the baptismal name, i.e. the Christian name, places you into a different, for lack of a better term, a different society. So that's that. The baptismal name it's not what people think it is. It's actually what the Jesuits did, what Loyola did, Ignatius Loyola did, was create a system to where he could grab the soul of man by separating the spirit from the matter, the physical matter. So, well, at least in theory. So the concept of baptism itself is the distillation or the separation of spirit from matter. So the whole concept of, and I'm going to leap ahead a little bit here, but the concept of Christ Mass, better known as Christmas, Christ Mass is everybody on planet Earth celebrating a singular pledge every year to that system, that belief system. And the Mass itself is the claim upon the afterbirth. Yeah, so the Mass is physical matter the church scraped together or pooled together, however you want to look at it, and they actually are in possession of your DNA. There's possession, and the DNA, the afterbirth, has a title, i.e. a name, and in my case, the afterbirth creature, the afterbirth Frankenstein, the afterbirth golem, whatever you want to call it, has a title, and in my case, the afterbirth is called Chris Richard Kallenbach. Yeah. It is not me.
Right.
It does have half my DNA, because remember, the afterbirth consists of what? It consists of the amniotic sac, the placenta, the umbilical cord, but it's all female. See, the thing people don't realize is afterbirth is all female. As only female, the female side of the equation. My mom does not contribute to the placenta. My father does not contribute to the that is all created within the female. So the afterbirth does not have a biological father.
Right.
So it is the Borg. It is the hive. It is the female side of the equation. In fact, if you follow it through. And I've talked about this before, but if you follow that afterbirth mama's boy all the way through, it's basically mother's mother, all the way back. My dad's mother is not even involved in the afterbirth. So the father has nothing to do biologically with the afterbirth itself. Therefore, it's a mama's boy, so to speak. And there is no inheritance. There is no title. There is nothing going with from father. That is truly an immaculate conception. Right, I thought you'd enjoy that, yeah.
Yes, that's wonderful.
Jeez.
Yeah, it's scary is what it is.
Very, very cleverly done the whole thing, and you have been a really real proper Sherlock Holmes with this.
It's interesting that they keep the mother part of the DNA, and yet they put out to all of humanity this thing about putting women down and start all this thing.
Yes, and it's the feminine that produces everything, yet we're worthless.
Well, they know that. That's why they created
the
patriarchy. But look what they've done is the mother itself is the producer of everything. And of course, because all of those afterbirth children, so to speak, they need a father. So the state, Rome, becomes its father, and ultimately the Pope becomes the vicar over all of it. So, dad's left out of the equation. Biological dad's left out of the equation completely. And then, so you have basically a stepfather being the priests and the priesthood, and the Pope is the father of all children on the planet.
Mm-hmm.
He's adopted all of the bastard children.
Wow, interesting.
Not you. That's where the misconception is. Is a lot of people when they talk about a slave state, and they talk about this system. What we fail to realize is that the only control they have is over the afterbirth. They have no control over us at all. In fact, the afterbirth that came in behind me, the second son, the younger half-brother of mine, who doesn't have arms or legs, or he's just a mass of cells, but nevertheless, he is a biological, he is related to me. It was related to me, but it only had my mom's side of the equation, so... It was relative to me, but it doesn't match me. But they can use me as surety because what that afterbirth, the DNA that afterbirth does carry, it does match me. So they pull me in and say, hey, you're not taking care of your kinfolk. You're not taking care of your brother. You see what's going on here? So that afterbirth is institutionalized. And so because there are costs or maintenance fees for that afterbirth, they're going to lay it on me. They're going to say, "Hey, we're watching over your family. You need to you owe us."
Kurt, do you know what's interesting about what you're saying as well? Because you know, only people that have had children will understand that the afterbirth doesn't just come out; it has to be birthed. It's a second birth.
It's a delivery.
Yes,
they call it that. And in fact, as long as I'm at it, let me pull. I'm going to go to Black's Law. You guys mind this if I go to Black's
Law?
No,
you're good.
Oh, no, go ahead. Yeah.
Shall we chat?
Yeah, this is a really sad situation. I went through this a little bit last night. It even shocked me. And nothing truly shocks me too much anymore. But this is a really weird thought. I didn't see this before last night, and when I was reading it, it really dawned on me how deep this goes. So it's, let's see. I'm looking for. Oh, there it is. I was spelling mother with a U. let me go to where.
I wonder what Freudian slip that was.
yeah. Well, I've been called mother spelled that way, but
it's
let me
funny.
See
it's
it.
Probably because mine Jerry's influence because we spell mum in England MUM. So you're probably picking up on us.
Well, let me read three words, maternal, maternal line, and maternal property. Actually, I'll read one more too, but maternal, that which belongs to or comes from the mother, as maternal authority, maternal relation, maternal estate, maternal line. The next word is maternal line, a line of descent or relationship between two persons, which is traced through the mother of the younger. Isn't that odd?
Mother of the younger.
So here you got this second child, the second birth, the second clump of cells coming out, which wouldn't that be a younger child than you? So let me read that one more time. I read it 10 times last night on the call, but listen to this again. Maternal line, a line of descent. That right there should perk up your ears. A line of descent or relationship between two persons. Look at that. two persons, me and that other person, Curtis Richard Kallenbach, that was created specifically for capture. So again, between two persons, which is traced through the mother of the younger. So the second birth child, Curtis Richard Kallenbach after birth, that's the younger of the two, but and that's the lineage,
that's
traced
the
through
line.
The younger. Yeah, that's the line.
So does now, that take you out of the line because you're not the younger?
Well, yeah, actually, I'm connected, but I'm not a direct link because I only have half the DNA. That remember that the afterbirth side of the equation is only mom's DNA because dad's DNA it doesn't make it, or especially the mitochondrial DNA. You know, the mitochondrial DNA is pure mom at this point. When dad's sperm, the mitochondrial DNA in my father's side is killed off at conception. So that side of the equation, the mitochondrial DNA only passes between females.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's interesting because it takes my thoughts in other directions as well, like why animals always eat their afterbirth. They always do.
Yes.
Well, I know that, you know, historically, the male, after delivering their own son or daughter, would have some form of ceremony and do something with the second birth, with that second child, so to speak. Of course, we don't know any of this because we've been, you know, all this stuff has been hidden from us for many, many years.
Yeah.
It's like the female animals are actually reclaiming their other part.
Yeah, they're not letting anyone else get that.
Yeah.
That they eat it. To get it off the land, and there's no other creature that can take it.
Yeah, and I mean, whether there is any value to it nutritionally, I don't know. But I mean, again, it's just nutty to me what's going on, and it's really hard to fathom that there are people that I don't believe most of the governments or any of the bankers or even most of the attorneys that are behind all this crap. They probably really don't know the details of it. I have to give them that, but the reality is when you start to see this stuff, when you realize that the judges in these courts, they know what they're doing is wrong. They may not know the details, but they definitely know what they're doing is wrong.
Yeah.
So you can't give them a pass on that. Anyway, two more words here. Maternal property. That which comes from the mother of the party and other ascendants of the maternal stock. Maternal stock. That's an interesting concept. And then finally, materna, maternus. It's a Latin term. It says a maxim of the French law signifying that property of a decedent acquired by him through his mother descends to the relations on the mother's side. Again, another interesting idea. So
it makes me wonder what they really do with the afterbirth, for one thing, because we're only told they burn it. We don't really know what they do with it or what they do with it before they burn it, if they burn it. But the other thing is, it's interesting that that's the female part, and then if a male is born, they want the foreskin. They probably put it in the same place.
Well, I think the foreskin obviously does well, but it shows a participation in the Christian religion.
Right.
I mean, that's because it's just part of the initiation for Christianity. You know, I don't recall ever kind of giving him a thumbs up and saying, go ahead and do that. I don't remember that.
Well, it wasn't done in my day at all, really. I never heard of anyone doing that.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's sad that we've been forced into these situations, but, you know, it's that old joke, you know, cutting the ends off the ham. You know, why do we do that? I mean, every Christmas, you know, we cut the ends off the ham, and everybody keeps doing it. And finally, one of the gals finally asked, why do we do that? And they say, well, I don't know, ask Grandma.
Yeah.
And Grandma says, well, when I was younger, we just didn't have a big enough pan.
Yeah.
There's no other reason than you know, two generations ago that the pan was too small, but now they continue to do it, but nobody ever asked
why. Why did it? Because my mother always did it. I've heard that story. It's brilliant.
Yeah. So I think that we do that every day.
We just keep doing things because we've just been doing them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the back to I kind of got off track there, but back to the Exorcist movie. That's an interesting movie to watch with the subtitles on, especially if you know anything about the history of like the District of Columbia and everything else, or the idea that we're all acting in a, you know, we're acting on the behalf of that afterbirth. We're all acting in you know, on behalf of that character. And she, the woman in the movie, is an actress on location, renting a flat, a residence in the District of Columbia. That's where the movie was supposed, I mean, the movie she was in was being filmed. I'm not talking about The Exorcist. I'm saying that she was an actress, and she was the main character in this movie, but her character was an actress. You know what I mean? And so
yes,
she was, she was acting in a movie on location in the District of Columbia, and she was separated from the father of Reagan, the daughter, the possessed daughter eventually. And the father, the biological father, was actually in Rome on doing something. So it's a really strange...
Also, with that movie, Kerr, I mean, it. You know, I've read up how that started and how that came about, and it's actually taken from a real live event that's said to have taken place in Washington, D.C. with a boy who was very badly possessed in that way.
Well, think about when you cut ties with this afterbirth. Remember, the church is possessing you physically through the DNA of the second son, the afterbirth itself. So by their claiming possession of that, they're possessing you indirectly. So when you can cut ties with the church by either truly claiming the entirety, the afterbirth itself, or somehow severing all ties, but I don't think that's a good idea. Yeah, I actually think it's better just to claim it. Claim it up front and then say, listen, whatever you guys did with it was wrong, but it was mine to begin with. You know, it matched me. It was my, it was relative to my existence, and you stole it from me. You know,
yes, because
without,
if you try to sever anything, there's no closure. You need to resolve the issues first.
I don't like the word sever anyway, because the concept of severing the relationship with that particular situation, the IRS actually looks at the afterbirth as something that has been severed or separated from you. Think of your physical DNA as a mass of cells, which it is, and then think of another smaller mass being separated or severed from the larger mass. They call that smaller mass an individual. That's the legal individual. The afterbirth is the legal individual with that title. So the IRS, remember that child, so to speak, for lack of a better term, has been institutionalized since its birth. And so it has its own place, its own space, whether it's in a cemetery or a tomb or a vault or on a shelf. It doesn't matter. The reality is there's maintenance fees so they want to extract the maintenance fees, but they actually physically need something that they can say, listen, we're watching over a family member of yours for you because you've never taken responsibility for that family member. So we have fees attributable to that family member, i.e. the afterbirth. And so what we're going to do is extract what you see as taxes, but ultimately they're just church tithes because the church is watching over this sad old soul. The soul, you know, the soul of this incapacitated individual.
Now, do you think they're doing this in some clever way for those that weren't born in hospital, or do you think that the midwives that birthed those children ran off with the afterbirth instead and gave it in, or what do you think about that? I mean, I was born at home, and that's always my question about that. I know
I don't
would have been a
remember midwife. The bankers have done this globally since the 1930s.
Yeah.
So I mean, and they've always known that the afterbirth was tied to the firstborn. They've always known that. So I just think what they did back in the 30s is they started collecting it, both the title. Remember, you have the Anno Domini calendar character. And then what they did is they added the DNA to it, which made it a very strong position for the court, because now they actually have physical possession of you indirectly.
Yeah.
Now, as far as not being born in a hospital, the hospital is ultimately the easiest way, because the hospitals are called foundling hospitals, which is where orphans are left on the doorstep, so to speak. Mm. And those are they're foundling hospitals, but and they're also the Knights Hospitaller, better known as the Knights of Malta. They created the hospital system, the Red Cross, the Rosicrucians. They created the hospital system for pilgrims, Christian pilgrims, looking for a better way. So, I mean, think about the birth process all by itself, and think about the ship that, let's say, the ship is in a tempest of some sort, and the ship is falling apart. And so when you exit the ship, i.e. the baby, and then you're found on shore somewhere, dazed and confused, you're a pilgrim. Mm-hmm. You're a pilgrim. I mean, the vessel may not be, I mean, the vessel I arrived in was called Curtis Richard Kallenbach. It may not have had the name Nina, Pinta, or Santa Maria, but nevertheless, it was a ship that came ashore to the United States or the Americas.
You know, Kurt, I don't want to interrupt your train of thought and we'll carry on, but I'm just going to throw some little things here because they come to my head. I know Jerry knows, but I don't know if anybody else realizes. What's her name, Kate?
Kate of Guy?
No, what's her name, who married...
Kate fucking...
Excuse you.
Sorry.
The Royal
Kate. Royal Duchess of Cambridge, or whatever her flipping name is now.
Yeah, when she was in hospital having the baby, there was photographs of her coming out holding the baby, and the nurse, they took a close-up of the nurse's belt, and it was actually a Masonic belt she was wearing.
Uh-huh. Really?
Yes. That's all on David Icke's shows. He's got all the pictures up there.
Yeah.
Well... all of the pieces, I mean, it's all Masonic.
Middleton.
The whole game, the whole thing is Masonic. The problem is we you know, we choose all these different paths, be it Muslim or Christian or Mormon. It doesn't matter what it is. They all emanate from the same source. They made enough flavors of the belief systems where there's something for everybody. But they all emanate from the same source. And that's ultimately, you know, the Vatican. So, and the Masonic system itself, the people that know, I mean, even the divine proportion, the golden ratio, the rectangle itself is the same dimensions that the Masons built physical structures with. So, I mean, the construct, the psychological or mind construct of the divine proportion and building cultures or building societies, in fact, in Black Law, it's called a building society. But the thing is that physically the Masons use the same dimensions in the real world to build their cathedrals and their other structures. So the divine proportion is both physical and mental. So the Freemasons, you know, they go all the way back to the Pythagorean Brotherhood, and the Pythagorean Brotherhood, you know, they were using mathematics exclusively.
I just can't. I'm laughing to myself because so many dot connects come up now. It's just like when you mention the Masons and everybody knows they're depicted as the master builders, and then you talk about building societies. Well, that's actually what everybody in England, what do they call it here, Jerry? In England, when you go to borrow money to buy a house, it's called a building society.
Yes.
That's what it's called.
Yeah, something similar. It's not instead of the banks, and we have all our savings in the building society.
Yeah.
Really? I didn't know that.
Yeah.
You don't go to a bank to get a mortgage. You go to a building society to buy a house.
Well, here's the concept of the mortgage, and as long as you brought that up, when you go to the bank anyway, let's say to buy a house, ultimately, what is being mortgaged? Is the house being mortgaged? Is the physical land underfoot with the house on it, is that being mortgaged? No, it's not. What's being mortgaged is you.
Yeah.
Your life, the title, is being mortgaged. So when a sheriff, if you fail to make payments over X number of months and they do a sheriff sale or something, what they're really doing is they've sold off that the mortgage, or the sheriffs don't come in there to take the house from you. What they're doing, ultimately it is the house, but you don't know what the house is. What they're doing is, let's say I had a house, and it was in the name Curtis Richard Kallenbach. If they come in and the sheriff say, I'm sorry, sir, but we have to escort you out of here. Well, what they're doing is they foreclosed upon the title Curtis Richard Kallenbach. That's all, the only right they have. So what they need me to do is believe that Curtis Richard Kallenbach is my name. So when they foreclosed upon the title, all of us think that they're escorting me out of the physical house. What they're really doing is moving the title, Curtis Richard Kallenbach, off of the physical property so that I, Curtis, abandon the physical property. So when Curtis, I, the physical man, the flesh and blood man, walk off the property, I have willingly abandoned that place. Now the property is abandoned, and then the bank comes in and takes abandoned property. It's the mortgage, the foreclosure was on my title, or the title Curtis Richard Kallenbach, not on that physical house. So I believe it's my name. The sheriffs think that they're foreclosing on a physical house, and nobody knows the truth. So when I leave the property or walk out with the sheriff, I'm actually abandoning the very house that I don't have to ever leave. I don't have to leave that house. A squatter could come in right behind me and take over that house, and nobody could ever get them out.
It is interesting because so many things are coming up with that now. I mean, in Ireland in particular, they have some really good cases where they've stood in the lawn in front of the house where they've come to take the title away from them. And the people who know what they're talking about have turned around to the policemen, these were not police officers, interestingly, mm-hmm. and informed them of their rights to uphold their oath to the people, and that they've walked away and taken the warrant officers with them, or bailiffs, we call them.
Yeah, because there are two parallel worlds going on. There's reality, and then there's construct. And reality, they don't remember the construct is paper. They don't have any right to the house when you lay your head down on a pillow tonight, on a bed in a bedroom within a house on some physical land, geographic land. They don't have any right to that. What they're doing is making a claim upon your life. And so when you live through that title, that golem, that afterbirth creature, that's what has been mortgaged. Your labor, your energy is what's been mortgaged, not that place where you physically are going to sleep tonight.
And that's what they create the money from. Is what the money doesn't exist until you sign your name on it, right? So that's the whole same concept.
Yeah, but again, all you're doing is making a promise to do something, and if you fail on that promise, basically to take care of that beast, that golem, that other creature, that's the problem. Is they don't really have any right to anything you do unless you choose to live through that thing. And now look at it. Now every time I go and buy anything through the title Curtis Richard Kallenbach, everything I do through that name, including get a job. If I go get a job through that title, everything I do, all of my productivity, every single thing I earn through that title goes to the caretaker or the caregiver. They allow me to keep some of it, but ultimately the chancery courts way back and always have upheld this. The chancery courts say that the church wardens are entitled to the usufruct as long as you're living under their roof. If you're under the church's care, the church is entitled to everything you earn.
I don't want to go off on too many different lines here, and just briefly, because it's a bit branching out, but isn't it to do as well with the governments are in fact corporations, so we are their employees, so we can't ever own a house or a car? Because it really belongs to them.
No,
that's a lot that's circling around the internet at the moment.
No. Remember what I just said about that title.
Yes, that's why I'm thinking that.
Okay, yeah. So baby boy Curtis, the biological baby boy, gets wrapped in a swaddling clothes and he gets taken home with mom and dad. The afterbirth gets swept up and put into some container. I'm trying to be vulgar here so people can actually get a feel for how disgusting this is. So they sweep it up and put it into some garbage can, and then they take a black marker and they write the name on the garbage can. It's Richard Kallenbach. It's no different. And then they take that garbage can into a registrar's office and say, okay, we have paperwork for this garbage. And the paperwork is Curtis Richard Kallenbach. That is a property that has been so-called abandoned or left behind for the state to lay claim to. Now, remember that what's in that garbage can is my DNA, at least 50% of it. So that and what is my DNA? My DNA is the land of my soul. It's actually it's land. It's my kingdom.
Where you live.
So what? Yeah. So they actually have a piece of my kingdom that they've laid claim to, an easement of sorts. So now what they have? They actually have a claim upon my existence. So now think, as long as I live through the title Curtis Richard Kallenbach, the afterbirth title, not my name, the afterbirth title, as long as I do everything through that, remember what happens. When baby boy is born, that's the end of it. What they do in a few days, 6, 7, 8 days, they announce in the public the birth of Curtis Richard Kallenbach. Now, what is their claim upon the announcement? Mom and dad clap their hands and say, hey, look, our son's name is in the paper. Mm-hmm. Ultimately, what are they doing? They're publishing the title. Now the title has been published into the public. Now it's no longer private, is it?
No, that makes much more sense.
Right. But what happens is nobody lays claim to it. These people are going to say, well, we put it out there and nobody claimed it. You know, like we found it, the lost and found, we left it there for a couple of days, yeah. But then we put it out into the newspaper hoping the owner would lay claim to it. And no claim.
And it's interesting.
So now it's abandoned.
Interesting as well how they tag babies when they're born? They put a little plastic thing on them with their name stamped on it.
Well, wait a minute. You just brought up a very interesting idea.
Yes, I thought so.
What exactly is the name that they have on your little plastic wrist or your wrist there? What does that plastic thing say? Does it say Curtis Richard Kallenbach or does it say something else? Ah, now you're getting down to the true name. What is the true name of the child? Well, in my case, the true name is Kallenbach, Curtis Richard. Why is that important to know? Well, now we're going back to the original photograph that I sent to you and with The Exorcist, the movie The Exorcist.
Yeah, it's on the website. I'm just going to put the link into the chat room again for people that have come in since.
I'm going to pull up the
I put it in here as well because I've got it here. That might be, you know, it's you can pull it up there.
Oh, you mean you're going to put it on Skype?
Yeah, I've put it on Skype for you. It's
okay. So there's, and then I sent you that other link that I think a scanned or a photograph of something
too.
I drew on a whiteboard this week.
It's there as
well. Yeah, that's there as well.
It's also there. The two.
Okay, let me pull it up then. Let's see. Oh, okay. That's not a link for me, though.
Oh, it's not live.
No, it's not. It's not a hyper.
It's not. It's,
that's okay. I'll just pull this up.
Something else in the chat room then, because that's obviously not putting it up as a separate page. I'm going to put.
There's a link. It's live now, Kurt.
Oh, it is.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the one I've put in's gone live. I don't know what happened to the Sheila's one, but it's come live now.
Yeah,
yeah, because when I copied the page, it didn't actually pull up the HTTP. So.
Mm.
That's beautiful. That, I mean, it comes out so clear. Okay, so here's the thing. So on my wrist, baby, living baby boy, the name is Kallenbach, Curtis Richard. Well, what has actually happened in the birth process? They've said, remember that the afterbirth, what is it? Basically a mama's boy. And I'm using it that way because it has basically mom's DNA, mom's side equation. And so dad doesn't exist in the afterbirth. Now, so what is my link to my dad? What is the evidence? I mean, what is the linkage between me and my dad? Well, it's his name. My father's name, my bloodline name, which is Kallenbach. So if they separate me from my father, first of all, biologically, the afterbirth is the only thing that's being registered, so there is no DNA there. It represents my dad. my biological dad. And so, and then what else did they do? They call it Curtis Richard Kallenbach. What have they done? They've actually separated me, my proper name, Curtis, from my bloodline father's name, Kallenbach. They put an impediment between me and my father. What did they put between me and my dad? They put the church. They actually separated it with another word, Richard. So Curtis Richard Kallenbach is a real problem because I cannot get to my father without going across the church property. Now think about that. If you're walking home, you got three adjacent properties, A, B, and C. They're all the same size square. And you want to get from your house to your friend's house, which between those two houses, there's a cemetery. And you can either walk straight from A to C and go directly through the cemetery, or you've got to take the long way home. You got to go all the way around, and go over or under. But the reality is there's almost really no way to get there. You actually have to go through the cemetery. And that's what they've done is they've created a situation via that title, Curtis Richard Kallenbach. In order for me to get to my father's property, my father's inheritance, to my father's family, I actually have to trespass across church property, which is the middle name, the baptismal name, Richard. What else can I do? I can pay a toll or a tithe, and they'll let me cross. There's all kinds of. I'm talking just language at this point. For me to get to my dad, or for my dad to get to me, we have to cross, C-R-O-S-S. We have to cross over church property.
I'm just going to interject here for the people that aren't in the chat room and maybe listening or the archives. You can find the pictures on if you Google Just Us Radio Network. And then on the bottom of the homepage, you'll see a page which says Kurt's Documents, and you can find these pictures on there. Could you explain, Kurt, how you came to the idea of unfolding that box to the shape of a cross?
Well, first of all, when I started going down the path of the divine proportion itself, which is the golden ratio, the rectangle. If you remember the picture of the rectangle, if you remember that document,
yeah.
When I talked about the basically the Fibonacci sequence is the easiest way to describe it, which is the 1-1 mom and dad, the 2, which is the zygote, the 3, which is the pre-emergent segment, and then it goes to the 5, which is the true man or the fully formed child, one head, two arms, two legs, the 5, the star.
And in this here as well, I've got two different things.
That's
here. You've
the
got
one.
Catholic Church and you've got Christianity.
Okay, so here's the thing. The box itself represents that ascension to the one, to the being whole. Now, when you look at the photograph there, it says man in the box. Uh-oh. I think I lost you.
Yep, no.
Okay,
no,
now
we're
I'm
here.
Back.
Yep. We're busy looking at the page.
Yep, we're looking at
now
the
I'm
box.
Back. Now I'm back.
Box.
Yeah. So there's you see the man in the box.
Mm-hmm.
That man in the box is ultimately where we're at. We're always there. That's us on our own. And that's how can I explain that? When we arrive, if we don't start thinking beyond the things we've been told. That when someone says to think outside the box, they really don't know exactly what they're saying because they don't know that they're in the box. In fact, think of a fish. A fish does not know that it's completely immersed or submerged in water. Because its surroundings is all water from birth to death, unless, of course, they're caught and pulled out. But the fact is a fish does not know it's in the water. Well, the box represents the construct. From birth to death, we don't know any different than the world that we're presented. So the box is that mindset. That's the box. And Curtis Kallenbach represents that mindset in the box. Well, here's the thing. It's when you start thinking beyond the box or outside of the box actually represents, I put the word Borg underneath that because for those people that are familiar with the Star Trek Borg concept, then you'll understand that the cube itself represents the Borg. I'm going to read what the Borg means, just so at least we're sort of in the same place here. The Borg is a very interesting concept. Most people just see it as a very ominous cube in a Star Trek movie. It's not. The Borg means something. In Black's Law Book, on page 167, the Borg is, this is what it says. In Saxon law, a pledge, pledge giver, or surety. The name given among the Saxons to the head of each family, composing a tithing or decennary, a descent, each being the pledge for the good conduct of the others. Also, the contract or engagement suretyship, the pledge given. So ultimately, in the movie, it says that you're going to be assimilated into this, it's a cube, into a culture. The Borg is what it was called. And that's exactly what Christianity is. Christianity is a mindset, and it doesn't matter from what direction you're coming. Again, all of it's Christianity when you go all the way back to the beginning. It's all Christianity when you go all the way back to the beginning, to its source. It is Christianity. Now, you know, I'm going to have a lot of Mormons arguing with me at this point, or Muslims, or whatever, but it's all the same stuff. It's just a belief system that... What's that?
I doubt they'd be listening. They probably, if they came across it, they probably switched off in the first 10 seconds and went to write a blog.
Well, that's okay, but that's what it is. The Borg, or the box itself, represents belief. Ultimately, that's what it represents. It's construct, but it's easier just to say it's belief systems. And the thing is that the cube represents the three-dimensional world that we live in. So here we are, 3D. Now, the problem is that the world that we, the construct itself, is basically two-dimensional. It's a 2D realm because it's all on paper. Well, I mean, when you go into the courtroom, the judge picks up a piece of paper, and they're saying that you represent what's on that page. Is that true?
Uh-uh.
Yeah, think about it. I mean, there's a name. There's a name on a piece of paper, and they're saying this is you. So here you are, a three-dimensional being chained to a two-dimensional page or piece of paper.
Yeah, it goes back to the 2D thing, like you showed just the 2D movie.
There you go. Well, yeah. There you go. And that's the Flatland is
Flatland,
a great
exactly.
movie. People
yeah.
need to watch that movie if they can get a hold of it. I watched it again this week.
It does put the pieces together when you see that.
I
so
love
here
the way your mind works, Kurt. You're very much like me with the Borg and Gollum.
Yeah.
My precious.
You know, when I first saw that movie, it was I was so grossed out by Gollum. I mean, just the way he talked and moved, and I was it just grossed me out. But I watched
just,
TV all the
time.
They're
missing it, rubbing their hands, my precious.
So the Borg, the cube, represents the 3D aspect of our existence. What's interesting about that is that when you unfold the three-dimensional cube, it unfolds into what we recognize as a cross. And that's not happenstance. That's not happenstance. The people that created the system that created that cross, the Rosicrucians, the whole idea of the bloodline, the rose cross, is all it is the rose represents blood. It's a bloodline. It's a descent. It's a bloodline descent. So anyway, the idea of the Borg is that we have all been brought into a mindset. The word is assimilated, and ultimately we have been possessed by just not only figuratively but physically as well through the DNA, the afterbirth. Subject to the Catholic Church as a pledge, which is what the Borg means. It's a pledge. And Christianity is the Borg itself. It's a mindset. It doesn't matter what version of it you're immersed in. It is a mindset. And most of the people, billions of people on this planet, believe in some version of Christianity. some version of it, which means it's no, again, it's no different than being assimilated into a global culture of insanity. And the Pythagorean Brotherhood has created a system where the people that want to participate in that insanity are ruled by a different set of rules. And sadly, the rules that we see in the courtrooms are the ones that, I mean, the speeding tickets, the DUIs, that's all for the people that are in that insane culture. The people that are completely considered reasonable do not believe in such nonsense. And I hate to be so harsh, but you're being punished for not thinking. People are being punished for not thinking.
Do you know, I'm going to throw something else in here just because it's the way my mind works. I've still got this golem in my head. And what is he after all the time? He's after the gold ring. What does that say about marriage?
Oh, yeah.
That's what he wants. My precious, my precious. It's the wedding ring he wants.
You know what's really weird that you brought that up? We don't know.
That's why.
Yeah, yeah, maybe so, but what we don't know is that the marriage is actually the divine male and divine female. The marriage. That's the true wholeness. And what we have done is we've been divorced. And they actually, when you look up and you find out what they're actually speaking of, when they're speaking of divorce, it's the divorce of the divine male from the divine female. That's the divorce. And so because the divine female has been separated from the husband, the caregiver, the male side of the equation, that divine female falls under the care of the state. And so the divorce is within ourselves. And we have, because we don't lay claim to both sides of the equation, we basically are living through the golem, through the afterbirth, the mama's boy in my case, Curtis Richard Kallenbach, and I have walked away from the divine male. The divine male. So by living through that mama's boy, I have divorced myself or wounded myself. That's the war. That's the war. The war is in our head. And it's never going to end. That Bible book is going to continue forever until we wake up from that that construct, that belief system, so to speak.
They found another Bible now, incidentally, from so many thousand years ago that's all black and it's been hiding away in Turkey, I think, or somewhere, that suggests that Jesus was never crucified and so many other things. But that's by the by.
What a surprise.
We don't have... Sorry?
It was a surprise.
Yeah, we don't have much long before the break, and after the break, I really want to, and we all, as we all want to, go on to solutions and what we can do about it. But if I can just take you a step back again, because I did interrupt you when you were talking about walking through the graveyard, and isn't it funny how we all feel eerie and shivery when we're walking through a graveyard, and there's absolutely no reason for that.
Right.
No, and the sick part about the grave, the concept of the graveyard, the churchyard. That's actually what it is, and we are supposedly the what's called the parson. That's P-A-R-S-O-N, I think. And so we're supposed to be the caregiver or the one watching over that church property. But instead, what we do is we take that church property, that grave site, and we profit from it. We take it into commerce, which is the ultimate desecration of that grave. It is the ultimate desecration of that, the memory of that baptismal saint. So when I take Curtis Richard Kallenbach into commerce, I am the ultimate sinner. So that's what we're doing, is we're actually using that character, that beloved saint, the character, the church character, the church property, and I'm taking that property into commerce and profiting off of that. Off of that that church property. That's what the church is looking at it as. And I know it sounds kind of funny, but I mean, they don't have any say over Kallenbach, Curtis Richard. Think about that before the break. When I go from Kallenbach to Curtis, when I go from my bloodline, my father, Kallenbach, the family name, over to myself, Curtis, to the proper name, Kallenbach, comma, Curtis. Do I have to cross church property?
No.
No.
Go direct.
I go straight. My father can reach me, and I can reach my father.
Mm-hmm.
It's an interesting concept.
Nothing in the middle.
Yep.
Nothing between me and my family. No pledge. Yes. No pledge. No churchyard. No church property. No memorial. No nothing. I don't have to trespass. I don't have to pass. I don't have to make a deposit, a donation. I don't have to do anything. I can get right to my family by going using what's called the true name. The true name, Kallenbach, comma, Curtis Richard. That's the true name.
Mm-hmm. Go straight on without stopping at the jail.
Yeah, I don't have
the monopoly
to.
Board.
Don't have to make any payments. Yep. Don't have to pay the church to allow me to see my dad.
Yeah. Go direct.
Go direct. So.
Nobody in between you. Yeah.
Okay. Quickly before the break, do you want to run through anywhere else that we can find information? I know we're trying to put things up as you give them to us on the Just Us Radio website. Do you have anywhere else that people can go to?
Well, yeah, I'm going to be putting a whole lot of stuff up at a site that my good friend Cynthia has assembled for me, and that site is trustandcontract, all one word, trustandcontract.wordpress.com, and there's a lot of stuff there. I mean, in fact, there are a lot of old stuff that I wrote over the years, so you could actually kind of piece my journey together if you wanted to look at the old stuff. And it's interesting because I haven't really put that much out other than 4 years ago I started with a withdrawal of consent, and then I about 2 years ago I was into some documents that people found as they call them the forgiveness docs, and then basically the paramount claim or divine proportion docs in the last 6 months or so. So there's a lot of stuff there, but it's all pretty much connected to the same direction. It's pretty easy to follow.
Yeah, I've just put it in the chat room, so anyone that's there can find it.
Jerry, do you want to mention Cynthia before we go on to the break?
Yeah, well, Cynthia's actually going to, she was on a couple of weeks ago, and she's going to join us again on the, I think it's the 3rd of May, to have another little talk. So, you know, she and Kurt kind of think the same way. They both got sort of their own personal ways of doing things, but individual, should I say. But yeah, so she's going to be on the 3rd of May, which is a Saturday. So yeah, it's a couple of weeks from now. Yeah.
And you can find her archive of the last One Point of View show. Was it a One Point of View or did we do him?
Yes,
Thomas?
I think hers was a One Point of View that time. This time it's going to be
in the archives, and it's also up on our YouTube channel.
Yes, you can find everything in a way. Yeah, just go and Google Just Us Radio Network and find all those things. So, yeah.
Okay, time for another boogie.
All right, let's get dancing shoes back on, everybody.
You're gonna walk this talk and talk the walk. You're gonna walk this talk and talk the walk. You're gonna walk this talk and talk. My brothers and my sisters. You're gonna walk this talk and talk the walk. You're gonna walk this talk and talk the walk. You're gonna walk this talk. Go around, come around, back at you. A word you speak is promise you vow to keep. As you sow, so shall you reap. Go now, have your little fun, for nothing is hidden under the sun. Let your yea be yea. What you conceal is the very thing that easily reveals. you're gonna walk the talk and talk. My brothers and my sisters, you're gonna walk the talk and talk the walk. You're gonna walk the talk and talk the walk. You're gonna walk the talk.
All right then, so I guess we're back.
I guess so. I'd like to mention that that song is called Walk the Talk by Rocky Dawuni. You can find it on YouTube. I've put the link in there. Jerry and I like to have music that we can really boogie to because, yeah, after all, what is finding yourself all about?
Yes.
What is it, Jerry?
It's about having a good time and enjoying your life in this physical body.
What's it about, Kurt?
It's about paying that man royalties.
I'm sure he wouldn't mind sharing if he didn't have to pay for a roof over his head and food in his belly.
Do you know, things keep coming into my head, and I'm just going to throw this one out, and then I'm going to be quiet and let you talk. When you were talking about the Bible before, you know, as I said, like, that I have memories of going back up until the age of 11, the things we were taught and the pictures that I have in my mind. And it's interesting that some things that are in the Bible, even though it's constructed in a certain way, do actually ring true when you look at them. Because I often, when we're going through the money system and that, the image that comes to my mind is when Jesus walked into that church where people had money all over the table and he threw it everywhere. He knocked the table over with all the money.
Mm-hmm. Well, the thing about the Bible is it's a wonderful story. And if we actually took it to heart and really, really understood what was being said in that in those words, the world wouldn't be this way. The money changers, that when you're talking about overturning the tables of the money changers, see, mm-hmm. we don't realize it, but that's what we do. We are the
yes.
bankers.
Yes.
And by living through that title, people don't realize it, but that's those titles are the reserves resources. And so the title itself, we are the Federal Reserve.
Value.
We are the Federal Reserve. We're the reserve source to the legislature for all funding. We're it. We're the guarantors.
Yep. And it's interesting that that scene happened inside a church.
Well, it also happens inside of us.
Yes,
I mean, by us claiming that name is a coin. We're actually coining money every time we put our pen to paper. We're coining money. We are the bankers.
Yep.
So we're changing money in the house of God, our physical bodies. We're the money changers. We're the ones that initiate all that stuff. We're it. We are the beast. We're the problem.
And isn't it funny that we all see that scene in a similar way?
Well, sadly, that's the way the system's been designed. It's been designed to, I believe, filter out. I mean, look at the people that like to lay claim to the labels. I don't. I hate labels. I hate brands. I hate being thought of as a brand. I mean, Curtis Richard Kallenbach is a brand. It's a brand, no different than a horseshoe burned into my, into my butt cheeks. It's a brand. It seriously, I mean, when I wear that thing, it's no different than wearing a brand on my shirt sleeve saying, hey, I belong to this particular farm, this particular ranch. And then the ranch just happens to be called the state of Illinois. So, I mean, I don't like brands. I don't like titles. I don't like names are for things. They're not for the living. They're for things. So when you decide to claim a name, I mean, if somebody were to call me Curtis or whatever, my head will turn. So it's a wave to get my attention. But am I Curtis? No, I'm not. Names are for things. So, in fact, I should probably cover that real quick. The different names. Is that okay?
Yeah, that would be really good.
And it's pretty scary because even the word name, and of course people, they probably have known, but noticed by now that all of my definitions come out of Black's Law, 5th edition, unless otherwise noted. Why? Because the world, the construct itself, is entirely constructed of the terms, the legal terms within that book. The entire planet, the construct is based upon the legal terms within Black's Law.
Is that legalese, Kurt?
It is legalese.
Okay.
So when I talk or speak about these terms, I want people to know what it is that's being used against them.
Yeah. And they're speaking a foreign language, basically, in legalese.
It is a foreign language. It's the Book of the Dead.
Yeah. It's a language that we don't speak, and the definitions they have are not the definitions we have in English.
No,
it's a
not at all.
Language, and that's a good thing to really point out, that all that language is like a foreign language because they have the words have different meanings.
Now, what's interesting, think of it as a foreign language for a very, very specific foreign country.
Mm.
So when you're in that territory, that is the language that is being spoken. So when Curtis Richard when I embody Curtis Richard Kallenbach. When I breathe life into Curtis Richard Kallenbach, the only place Curtis Richard Kallenbach lives or exists is in that territory. So Curtis Richard Kallenbach is completely subject to that language. So when I live through or act through Curtis Richard Kallenbach, I can't bitch about the language. I don't have any right to say that you know what you're saying, the word understand or the word person or all these other legal terms don't apply to me. Yes, they do. When I'm living through Curtis Richard Kallenbach, yes, they do. That thing, that afterbirth creature, exists in a territory only where the legalese is the language. It doesn't exist anywhere else. So for all the people complaining about the court system and everything else, the character they're living through and the legal terms that it is subjected to, hey, that's the rules. It's the rules of that territory. If you don't like playing Monopoly, quit playing. If you don't want to play, quit. And I guess we can talk about that at some point, but what I've found, but let's get through just a couple of these concepts of names first, because people don't have any idea. First of all, a name is for a thing. It is not for the living. It's not for you and it's not for me. If you're willing to be to answer to in my case Curtis, if somebody says hey Kurt or Curtis or whatever, and I turn my head, I have ultimately laid claim to that so-called calling. So if I'm willing to turn my head, it's only to it's because maybe I recognize the voice. But the point is that if they could have said hey you. If I'm the only one out there in my yard and somebody says, hey, you, I'm still going to turn my head.
Yes.
So, I mean, realistically, it's just to differentiate us between each other when we're together. Yes. Otherwise, hey is good enough for me.
Right.
Anyway.
Names. Yeah.
We don't need names. Names are labels.
Yes.
Names identify things. Anyway, the word, this is all out of Black Law again. Name. Black Law 5th edition. Name. The designation of an individual person or of a firm or corporation. Well, let me stop there for a second. It says of an individual person or of a firm or corporation. Isn't it funny? Corporation, not alive. Firm, not alive.
Yeah.
And look at how they used individual person. Now, early on in this call tonight, I told you that the afterbirth has been separated or has been severed from your wholeness. That afterbirth is called an individual. You're not an individual. It is an individual. So the individual that has a title is subject to the IRS. You are not.
Yeah, right.
So it's funny that the word name says the designation of an individual person or of a firm or corporation. Where's the living? A name is not for the living. It goes on to say, a person's name consists of one or more Christian or given names and one's surname or family name. Well, first of all, you have to know that the word or means and. So whenever you see the word or, just automatically assume that they're saying and. But it says, consists of one or more Christian or given names, and one surname or family name. Well, it is the distinctive characterization in words by which one is known and distinguished from others, and description or abbreviation. It is not the equivalent of name. So it's you're going to find that the word individual and Christian comes up quite often here. Now, surname, the family name, the name over and above the Christian name, the part of a name which is not given in baptism, the name of a person which is derived from the common name of his parents, the last name, the name common to all members of a family. But it's still the surname. It says the family name, the name over and above the Christian name. Isn't it interesting that all of a sudden the word surname has been attached to Christian name? If there's a Christian name, it's almost the way this is written. If there's a Christian name, it's presumed there's a surname. Okay, full name. The full name, the first, middle, and surname of a person. Or the first name, middle, initial, and surname may also refer to name under which a person is known in the community. Now, if you follow the thought pattern, it says in surname, it pulls in the concept of a Christian name. Full name says the first, middle, and surname of a person. Well, first, middle, and surname in my case is Curtis Richard Kallenbach. So now, I mean, they call it a middle name, but the middle name is the baptismal name or the Christian name. So it's first Christian surname. And then legal name. This is where it gets really interesting to me. Legal name. Under common law consists of one and one surname. And the insertion, omission, or mistake in middle name or initial is immaterial. Well, wait a minute here. One Christian name and one surname. Well, in my case, is Curtis a Christian name? No. That's a proper name. So the Christian name is Richard in my case. So it says legal name, one Christian name and one surname. So the legal name that is that would be connected to me can only be Richard Kallenbach.
Right. Wow.
But it goes on to say, and we're going to go right back to the word individual here. It says the legal name, in quotes, of an individual consists of a given name or baptismal name, usually assumed at birth, and a surname deriving from the common name of the parents. Wait a minute, what did I just say? Or means and. So the legal name of an individual consists of a given name, Curtis, and baptismal name, Richard, usually assumed at birth, and a surname, Kallenbach, derived from the common name of the parents. So the legal name of an individual is Curtis Richard Kallenbach in my case. It goes on to say, Christian name, the baptismal name as distinct from the surname, the name which is given one after his birth or at baptism, or is afterward assumed by him in addition to his family name. Such name may consist of a single letter. Really? So on the driver's license, when it says Curtis R. Kallenbach, that's acceptable? Well, hell yeah. The Christian name can have a singular letter, and it's still considered a Christian name. So the letter R, Curtis R. Kallenbach, is still considered the same as Curtis Richard Kallenbach.
Yeah.
Now, here's where it gets really crazy. Remember that when they use the word Christian name, the word assumed has been used every single time. Every time. So look at what the word assume means. To pretend, to undertake, engage, promise. Promise, well, there's the Borg. Remember that pledge. It goes on to say to take to or upon oneself. Also taking up, receiving, adopting, taking to oneself or to put on deceitfully. Take appearance of, effect, or outwardly seem. To take on, become bound as another is bound, or put oneself in place of another as to an obligation or liability. So again, when I put myself in place of Curtis Richard Kallenbach, the afterbirth, I become liable for everything it has been attached to. In other words, citizenships, memberships, associations, anything that they have attached title to, I become obligated or bound to it just by assuming that name to be mine. So I have basically, it is deceit. In fact, the legislature has been writing for the last at least 20 years, laws against or basically protecting identity. So identity theft laws have been really, the proliferation of identity theft laws is because they know that 100% of the American people are using names that are not theirs lawfully. The entire place is nothing but criminals.
Hey.
Because we have assumed a name that is not ours.
Yeah.
Hey. Yeah. Is that your name? Hey.
Hey, you.
yeah. you, you, hey, know there are two others on this call. You better be very specific. I'll go by Hey You.
Okay. I just want to, for the people listening, just go through the calling number. We do welcome callers. It's 718-506-1564. And we also have a question that I've put in here in the chat room. Do you want to read it out, Jerry?
We need to put out the phone number. Sorry. Down the bottom. Agree with what Kurt is saying. Still would like to know how to function after doing all that. Like travel around town, out of country, when have to work, not retired here, no property. It's a little bit of a bitty question, but basically would like to know how to function after you've done all the things, and that how to travel around town and out of the country.
In other words, what I feel you're saying, yeah, is when you've done the paperwork and that, how do you actually cope with traveling around and being stopped and blah, blah, blah?
Okay,
well,
first let's think about what is a driver's license? What is a license? A license is permission to do something that is otherwise unlawful. So what is the license? Well, remember, we have not claimed anything. We have not claimed our own names. Remember, what is my true name? The name that was actually on the band of my wrist. Mm-hmm. It was Kallenbach, Curtis Richard. I've been living through Curtis Richard Kallenbach for the better part of 53 years. Mm-hmm. So in order for, and remember, since I have not laid claim to my property, it has been put into a trust, into a trust situation. And whether it's been for centuries, generations, it doesn't matter. Nobody in my family lineage has laid claim to anything because we're all fatherless, apparently. Mm-hmm. So what is the driver's license? The driver's license is the state giving you permission to basically be in possession of somebody else's property, even though it really is you and it is your property. Since you've never laid a claim to it, you need permission from the fiduciaries that have a responsibility over that property, okay? So that's the only reason you need a license, is because you're not really, you're driving somebody else's property around, even though it's your DNA, even though it's you, you've never claimed you. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what's so crazy about this. Yeah. So you need permission from the trustees or the fiduciaries that have a responsibility for that property. You need their permission to drive you around. Yeah. Okay, so when you clear all this up, the first question is do you need a driver's license? For the first time in your life, I would have to say no. All the other stuff, all the other patriot mythology scares me to death, because you still haven't actually clarified what you're doing out there. So, I mean, if I'm driving Curtis Richard Kallenbach around, somebody else has a fiduciary responsibility to protect that property until the true owner of that property comes forward, and that would be me. So the paramount claim upon the DNA aspect of my existence is a good place to start. Mm-hmm. It's a good place to start. And so in the 3D world, in the common law 3D living world, recording that paramount claim upon your DNA, the entirety of your DNA, which includes the afterbirth, that would be a good place to start. The second step, I'm going to just tell you what I'm going to be doing. I've done two out of the three. The second step is to get rid of, or not really, but it's to lay claim to the statutory title, the true name. And the only way you can do that in Illinois, and I'm only going to speak to Illinois because I don't know about the rest of the continental U.S., but in Illinois, they call it an assumed name. And so in Illinois, especially in Winnebago County, Illinois, they had paperwork that was actually three parts, white over yellow over pink, and that was for an assumed name. Now, what was it that I actually did? Why did I go get another assumed name? Because realistically, I never had an assumed name to work with. Now, remember, I'm a 3D living man, and their world is 2D paper. How can I interface with a 2D paper world if I'm a 3D man? The only way I can do that is through the hand of the king. I'm the king, and my right hand, when it has pen in hand, I can interface with the 2D realm through my hand, the hand of the king. So I actually have to have some way that the 2D world can deal with me. And the only way they can do that is with a name, a title or a name. So what I did is I got a new assumed name, because the assumed name that was registered back in 1960, the name that was registered was Curtis Richard Kallenbach. That's the name of the afterbirth. But what did they do? They gave that afterbirth an assumed name, Curtis Richard Kallenbach, all caps, that could be used in the commercial realm. So Curtis Richard Kallenbach, all caps, is an assumed name, but it's tied to the afterbirth character, so it's fraudulent for me to use it. But they did create it for that character, that golem, that Frankenstein, that beast. They did create an assumed name that could be used in the commercial realm. And, of course, Curtis Richard Kallenbach, all caps, or Curtis R. Kallenbach, all caps, is an assumed name. So what I needed to do is to no longer use that assumed name or even have any connection to it. So what did I have to do? I had to create a new assumed name that I would be willing to use that is not in a fraudulent capacity. So I went down to the county in Illinois, on Winnebago County, and I got the document that I needed for me and my wife to create a new proper assumed name for Kallenbach, comma, Curtis Richard. Now I actually have the real true name associated with an assumed name, and the assumed name I created was Curtis Kallenbach. So Curtis Kallenbach is owned by Curtis Kallenbach, upper and lowercase, and owned by Kallenbach, comma, Curtis Richard. So now when I'm out there in commerce, the king, 3D man, in a two-dimensional 2D world, when I want to interface with the commercial realm, I now have a lawful and legal ability to interface with their world, because I'm using my own property, not the creation of somebody else, and I'm certainly not desecrating the grave of the afterbirth. So Curtis Richard Kallenbach is the afterbirth, and when I use the assumed name created for the afterbirth, the church looks at it as me desecrating the grave. So I needed to create something that allowed me to work within their system, at least temporarily. Step three is a giant, giant step. Step three is actually withdrawing the assumed name Curtis Richard Kallenbach from that business organization that it was created for way back when, back in 1960. So for 53 years, Curtis Richard Kallenbach, upper and lower case, has been an assumed name tied to the afterbirth. I'm going to, when everything's said and done with step two, when that's all clear and that's all lawful, I'm going to take step three and withdraw from the assumed name that was given to the afterbirth back in 1960. So I'm going to go back to the county. I'm going back to the port of entry, so to speak, the commercial port of entry, where Curtis Richard Kallenbach first entered, and I'm going to withdraw any participation in that business organization. I don't know what kind of a business organization it is, but I know that it is one, and I'm going to withdraw from my participation. I'm going to basically take my deposit back, which is my DNA. The afterbirth has half of my DNA. It matches me. I have every right to that DNA. And I'm going to have that deposit returned to me through what is known as a withdrawal, just like at a bank account. I'm going to close that account, and I'm going to withdraw or get my deposit returned to me. Let me just read the word withdrawal real quick and withdraw, because Illinois Assumed Name Act, it actually tells you how to withdraw. So, in fact, I'll read the paragraph real quick, and then I'm gonna read the legal term withdraw and withdrawal. So so you can understand what it is I'm doing in step three. The answer to the question is, it's not a problem. The reason everybody's so worried about not being able to do what they're doing currently is because they think that all of a sudden they don't exist anymore somewhere, and that's not true. The problem right now is that you're existing through an afterbirth, a creature, a golem, a monster, and somebody else has a claim upon that or has a duty to protect that. And so everything you do is fraudulent right now. Everything is fraudulent because, A, it's not you. It's not you. And, B, you've never claimed anything that even connects you to that. So all you are for that beast, that monster, that golem, is the surety. That's all you are. So, I mean, nothing really changes. If you want to stay in the game, all you have to do is go do it lawfully. Go do it lawfully. So you can still do things. You're just not tied to their golem. Anyway, so here's the paragraph. It's the Assumed Business Name Act for Illinois, and it's 805 ILCS 405-3A. And here's the paragraph, and it tells you exactly what to do. And it says, any person who has executed and filed the certificate required by Section 1 or 2 of this Act and who wishes to withdraw his name from the business organization shall have the certificate canceled in whole or in part by filing in the office of the county clerk where the certificate is filed a supplementary certificate under oath showing that such person or persons have ceased doing business under the assumed name, or that the person or persons executing the supplementary certificate have no further connection with or financial interest in business carried on under such assumed name, whereupon the county clerk shall note opposite the trade name theretofore registered the word canceled and the date of cancellation, or, in case of withdrawal only, of one or more but less than all of the registrants, the clerk shall note the word withdrawn after the name of each party filing the supplementary certificate indicating the withdrawal, together with the date of such withdrawal. When such withdrawal effectuates any change in or transfer of the ownership of 25% or more of the total ownership interest in any such business organization doing business under an assumed name, then notice of the filing of such certificate shall be published. Here's the deal. Withdraw. So, to take away what has been enjoyed, to take from, to remove as deposits from bank or oneself from competition or candidacy. The word withdrawal. Remove money or securities from a bank or other place of deposit. Withdrawal from a conspiracy requires either making a clean breast to authorities or communicating the abandonment of the conspiracy in manner reasonably calculated to reach co-conspirators. People don't realize it, but when you're living or when you're doing things through that golem, through that afterbirth title, you are conspiring against the United States. It's a conspiracy. You're actually withdrawing from the conspiracy and you're getting your deposit back. What is your deposit? Your deposit is Kallenbach, Curtis Richard. So I like the Sestakavai Act says in Section 4, when a man proves life, the title will be revested. So, and there's one other word I want to, people don't realize it, but when you withdraw, the word cancel is absolutely huge. So let me read cancel real quick, and then we can, then I'll stop talking. Cancel. Look at this. Cancel. I'll read cancel, and then I'm going to read cancellation. Cancel, to obliterate, to strike or cross out, to destroy the effect of an instrument by defacing, obliterating, expunging, or erasing it, to revoke or recall, to annul or destroy, make void or invalid, or set aside, to rescind, abandon, repeal, surrender, waive, terminate. The term is sometimes equivalent to discharge or pay. Think about that. They actually write canceled across the certificate. Gosh, I wonder what certificate that is. I wonder, could it be the certificate that actually created the assumed name that people recognize as the birth certificate? Yeah, I think it is. And then now the word cancellation, to destroy the force, effectiveness, or validity of, to annul or abrogate, defacement or mutilation of instrument, words of revocation written across instrument. Think about that. It says, occurs when either party puts an end to the contract for breach by the other and its effect is the same as that of termination. They're going to cancel the birth certificate. You know what they're going to do? They're going to take the afterbirth child and they're going to finally put it to rest. They're going to bury it. They're going to kill it. They're going to let it go to its burial ground. They're going to let it go to the headstone that they created at its beginning, at its inception. They're going to put Curtis Richard Kallenbach, the golem, in its grave.
Wow, that's
where
it
belongs. It's huge. The gravestone already exists. The headstone already exists. It's the all capital birth. It's the birth itself, the place for it. The place that this golem is supposed to be is in its interment, its birth. That's where it belongs. But we keep dragging it out because we keep using it. Hey, don't put that away. I'm not done using it.
Yeah, right.
Hey, I need that golem. Hey, don't put that away.
Let's stop it.
Yes, yeah, you know what? So you're going to R.I.P., rest in peace. You're going to put that thing, it's going to finally make it to where it belongs, and it's going to be there forever. And you know what? You're not going to cross paths with it. You're not going to trample across it. You're not going to desecrate its grave anymore. You're going to let it rest in peace. You're done. You're done using it.
Yeah.
What's interesting, hey, you.
Yeah, finally. Finally, somebody knows who I am.
Where was I? Oh my goodness. Oh yes, yeah, so because you're actually going to the root of all evil, so to speak, it should, in effect, take into account taxes going to work, driving licenses, passports. It should actually take that all into effect. So the only way we can really understand how they're going to take it, as somebody put in the chat room, is when it's tested, when somebody stops us, and depending on who that person is, that's all we can do.
Well, wait a second here. If anybody has their passport nearby, I think they should look at the name on it. I mean, you don't need a driver's license. What does the passport say? In my case, it says Kallenbach Curtis Richard.
Yeah, I'm understanding all this. I'm just saying it for the benefit of people listening and in the chat that we may still be challenged. We know what it means, but we are still going to be challenged. That's what I'm saying, and we don't know the outcome of that.
Not yet, but here's the thing is, remember, this is just business. It's pure business, and when you go through the proper channels, so to speak, not to use nautical terms, but when you do things the right way, when I'm using my passport, and if I were, first of all, if they run the plate that's on the car, it's going to go back to the situation that's already been handled. They're probably not going to stop me right off the bat. If they happen to stop me or they overlook something, which is very unlikely, and I hand them a passport, they're going to probably say, I'm really sorry, Mr. Kallenbach. I didn't realize. So, I you know what? The thing that we've been doing is we've been denying everything, but ultimately we never knew. We didn't know. I mean, we've been using somebody else's name our whole lives. I mean, the whole time, for the better part of 53 years, I've been using the name of the dead. The name of the dead.
So what do you want to do now? You said you went and, you know, re-registered the name of just Curtis.
I already did it.
So that's that's the name you're going to accept and acknowledge as who.
I'll do this. I'll send you a copy of the document. Is that okay?
That'd be great.
Are you guys good with that?
Sure.
Yeah, I was going to suggest to her that we can put anything that you wish us to on our website, along with Cynthia's, what she's doing as well.
Mm.
Okay, I'm going to send you.
It's very similar, but yeah.
I will send you the exact. I'll send you a scanned copy of my assumed name doc right now, and you can put that up. I mean, can you put that into so other people can see it?
Yep, I can do that. I'm sorry, I wasn't meaning that you send us anything as Cynthia's. I meant anything that you put on Cynthia's site, you can also put on our site, the one that Cynthia set up for you. So, okay, I'll have the page open and ready, and I can put that in there.
Let me see. Let me just open it up and make sure that I...
And the other thing is, it's interesting, I'm like in a... It's like I've had this discussion with Jerry so many times, and I don't want to take it... you know, take up time here because it is personal to me, really, and doesn't apply to a lot of other people listening, probably, but I'm actually an alien.
No, you're not.
Yes, so I'm still...
Aileen.
Yes. Aileen, yes. They put a lean on me when I came here with my green card, so I'm actually an alien, so, you know, I don't know where I'm going to go with that and how... I think I'm going to have to go back to England to...
First of all, now, did you guys receive this? Can you open it, or did it work?
Yes, well, it's here,
not,
yes, so we should be able to...
It's not finished yet, yeah.
Oh, does it actually show that it's trying to get to you?
Yes.
I'm not familiar with this. But here's the thing. Curtis Richard Kallenbach, you may or may not enjoy this, but Curtis Richard Kallenbach is already in a British colony.
Right. Yes.
Oh, yes. We're very aware of that. Yes.
Okay. So really, is that any? Am I actually any more or any less an alien than you?
Well, it actually says it in capital letters on my green card, so I don't know.
Yeah. I'll read the word colony, and this is going to be kind of crazy because when you hear the word mother, it's going to start to click. It's going to start to click. So let me read colony real quick, because it'll start to click in people's minds what the mama's boy, the mother's side of the equation has to do with any of this. Okay? So here's colonist. Colonist, this is page 240 on Blacksmith. Persons who have emigrated from their mother country to settle in another place but who remain loyal to the mother country. Colonus. In old European law, a husbandman, an inferior tenant employed in cultivating the Lord's land. Now, you got to really know, it says, a term of Roman origin corresponding with the Saxon, I think it's pronounced churl. C-E-O-R-L.
I don't know. Let me read.
Yeah, it's an old word, obviously, but let me see if I can find that in here. Churl.
How do you spell it?
C-E-O-R-L. Churl? Churl.
Yeah, it would be Seol. Yeah, Seol.
Okay. In Anglo-Saxon law, a class of freemen, personally free, but possessing no landed property. Is it starting to ring a bell?
Yes, absolutely. And
no,
we know that
property?
There's really no borders. We're just trying to get around the...
I'm talking about your DNA.
Yes, I understand.
So you have no landed property. You have no DNA, no land, nothing for you at all. You don't have any DNA. It's in possession of somebody else. So it says in Anglo-Saxon law, a class of free men, personally free, but possessing no landed property, a tenant at will of free condition who held land of the thane on condition of paying rent or services, a free man of inferior rank occupied in husbandry. Under the Norman rule, this term, as did others which denoted workmen, especially those which applied to the conquered race, became a term of reproach, as is indicated by the popular signification of churl. I guess it's pronounced churl there. And finally, the word colony. Colony, a dependent political community consisting of a number of citizens of the same country who have emigrated therefrom to people another and remain subject to the mother country. Territory attached to another nation known as the mother country with political and economic ties, e.g. possessions or dependencies of the British Crown. People don't realize that the title Curtis Richard Kallenbach was picked up by the bar. I mean,
yes,
the Crown actually laid claim to it. Yes, they absolutely.
I mean, the whole court system is British. Yes, we're
it absolutely is. Why?
Yes.
Because it's Crown property.
Yes. So does that mean that I could do the paperwork here the same as you? It doesn't matter where I am, in other words.
I actually think that what you're doing is the same. You're making the same claim because the system, you know, I mean, you might have to do wherever. I mean, obviously the location of birth makes a difference because that's where that's your port of entry. You know what I mean? That's where the living exited and the new commercial vessel came into being.
Yes, that's where I was birthed. Yes.
Yeah, and so I like to think of it as you when you were when you showed up when you first arrived, you never came ashore. You jumped ship and let the vessel, the amniotic sac and everything else, crash ashore, but it didn't have you on it. So what they did is they salvaged that vessel, the amniotic sac, placenta, whatever. They salvaged it, i.e., through Lloyd's of London. They're the ones, and of course, there's the Salvation Project of the Church. But they salvaged that vessel, and they fix it all up, and they send it back out to sea with the new title. Kallenbach is a commercial vessel out on the Sea of Commerce. The sad part is, it's flying the flag of the United States, the prophet for the United States, or whatever. But the sad part is that commercial vessel stays out to sea my entire life unless I can find my way back to the home port. Unless I can find my way back to the home port. So the vessel, the commercial vessel, Curtis Richard Kallenbach, is out to sea my entire life unless I can get it back to the home port and then finally land. I mean, you know, get grounded.
Can we put this in a nutshell? That you were really talking about three steps. I think the first step is to file the notice of, well, put in the notice of paramount claim.
The paramount claim is step one. That is you claiming the entirety
of you,
of your DNA,
yeah.
Of your DNA, your
now,
land.
The other question is now, us being, you know, having been born not on this land. Would we be better to be doing this in the area where we did actually show up on the Earth?
It probably would be wise to do it there as well. But you know what? Remember that the record is global.
Yeah.
There is only one record.
Yeah. So we can do it. I've been planning to do it here and in the... I'm looking to find the equivalent of a state... secretary in Britain, and I'm trying to work out who that's going to be.
The paramount claim, though, here's the thing: is a lot of things. The more I thought about it, the paramount claim, divine proportion document, which has your blood thumbprint on it, that all I can see happening there is getting that recorded onto. Or into the county record. And the county, of course, means the parish as well. So any way you can get it onto the record where it actually is recorded, that's your claim on your DNA, upon your land.
Yeah.
So if you could do that here, there's no reason that you shouldn't try to do it there as well. But, I mean, once it's recorded, or until it's recorded, I kind of wouldn't want it out of my sight. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Of course, if you can get it recorded over there through some friends after you get it recorded, you know, on a county or on a parish, that's step one. Step two, then, is what I sent you. It looks like it's taking a little bit longer.
Yes, I'm having trouble opening that picture. I don't know why.
I've
opened it, Jerry?
Yeah, I've got it here,
Can you email it to me, and then I can stick it on the website?
Yes, I can definitely.
Okay, so step two is actually now... laying claim to your true name for the first time in your life. Curtis Richard is the true name of the baby boy that went out of the hospital into swaddling clothes, the biological, living, breathing baby boy. Kallenbach, in other words, bloodline, father, last name, or not last name, but family name, Kallenbach, comma, proper name, Curtis, me, the living, breathing son, and then... That other notorious name, Richard, the baptismal. So that is the true name. What they did is they took that true name and they deposited that. That's the deposit. And what did they do? They attached it to the the afterbirth title. I mean, think about that. So they deposited my living essence, the true name. And then what did they do? Is I've been mistaken. I actually believe that Kallenbach, Curtis Richard, if you look at a birth certificate, is it a full-size sheet of paper? I mean, if you really look at it, is it a full-size sheet of paper? No. They place the form over another page, and then, of course, they copied onto the second page or whatever, but there was something at the bottom of the original. There was something at the bottom of the original, and I believe what was at the bottom of the original birth certificate was, in my case, Kallenbach, Curtis Richard, 9 pounds, 3 ounces, 21 inches long, you know, all the meets and bounds of the living. Mm. And that's the only evidence of me anywhere.
As a real
of my existence. Yeah. Yes.
And you're talking about the birth certificate as opposed to the certificate of live birth, because I know there's been talk about, you know, having one or the other. One is more valuable than the other. I've got an ancient handwritten thing. It looks like 100 years old. It's so kind of...
You don't sound anywhere near that old. But the thing, but remember too, though, that the certificate of live birth, let's just think about this, either or. The certificate of live birth is still not you.
No.
The certificate of live birth is the name of the afterbirth. It's the title of the afterbirth. Right. And what they do, and the birth certificate, of course, is the space created for the afterbirth. I believe the birth certificate, I'll say it one more time, the birth certificate is the space created, the burial space for the afterbirth.
Okay.
So when you're finally done using it, they take the afterbirth, whether it's figuratively or actually, and they place it in its burial ground, in its tomb, in its interment, in its place for interment for eternity, and that is the birth itself. Once they put that afterbirth into the birth, that character is gone. It's done. And so the certificate of live birth is for the second arrival, the second delivery, that's the afterbirth. The certificate of live birth is for the afterbirth. The birth certificate is the space they created on the shelf in the cemetery. That's the space that they created. So you have a title to a piece of property or a shelf space, and that's the birth certificate. The birth certificate is for a space.
Okay. Now, the interesting thing is mine, like I said, it looks ancient. It's handwritten. I've actually got it right here. And it's got all these watermarks on it. Really looks ancient. But it's all handwritten. And my name... My name is not written in caps.
Yeah, but it is. Is it first, middle, last?
It's got the date and the address where I was born, which is my parents' home. And then name, if any, Geraldine Margaret, girl... And name and surname of father.
Jerry, is that because that happened with mine as well? I asked for a copy of my full birth certificate because I originally only had one of the small ones. My small one, the original one, has my name in caps. The copy doesn't.
Well, this is a certified copy of, but this is the one that my mother had and she decided it was about time I owned it. And she sent it to me. This is the one that was created at my birth, as far as I know, that they were given. And it's all written in handwriting, and my name is written in lowercase except for the first initial. Geraldine is spelt with a capital G and Margaret spelt with a capital M. And then it says my father's name, John Michael Grant Jones, my mother's name, Ellen Jones, formerly Ovington, and then occupation of father, signature of father and his address, and the date that happened. And the signature of the registrar. So that's quite interesting. But meanwhile, I did send away for something more, the only thing I could find online, and it's a certified copy of an entry of birth. And it also has been stamped in a certain way, seal and stamped. It was it's a name somewhere to do with the stamping. Seal stamp of the general registrar, and it's certified. It's certified that it's a true copy of my birth certificate. And this is
Does it say true copy?
It said certified copy.
And we know that's different, don't we?
Yes, yeah. So that's different. Yeah. It's only a certified copy given at the General Register office. And again, there's no caps.
Yeah, I don't worry about
the caps. Oh, except Ellen Jones and Ovington and my father's name, but Geraldine Margaret's not in caps.
I just want to interject here that I put in the chat room. I'm just going to say to people listening that if you go to Just Us Radio Network, just ask Google, you'll find all the documents on the page that says Kurt's documents.
That's great.
I should change that to Hey Documents, shouldn't I?
Yeah.
Hey You Documents.
Yeah.
My grandmother had a cat called Hey You once, actually.
Okay.
So I don't really know. I don't really know the relevance of any of this, but it's just interesting that it's not. But their last names are written in caps. My father's last name is written in caps. My mother's married name is Jones is written in caps, and her maiden name is written in caps. But my name is not written in caps. It's written in lowercase except for the first initial.
Kurt, somebody's just put in the chat room, Truth Seeker, that you use your zip and address.
Ooh, that's scary, isn't it? No. If they're looking at this document, remember that that's not a scary thing. The assumed name is a fictitious name, and it's in the fictitious realm. By the way, that's not an address to a home. It's an address to a commercial drop. So it's not a problem because where it says Curtis Kallenbach, 1643 North Alpine Road, Suite 104, Box 186, Rockford, Illinois, 61107. That's not scary because it's not me. You see, it's my property, and it's not church property. I'm not laying claim to anything that is church property, which is the baptismal name. So I can do whatever I want to without trespassing across somebody else's property. The 61107 or the Rockford, Illinois, the fictitious location, I mean, a fictitious character cannot live in a three-dimensional realm. If you look at if you look just below that, where it says address of residence for the two owners, now we're talking about something different, where it says Curtis Kallenbach, address of residence, Rockford, Illinois, non-domestic. There's no zip code there.
Mm.
Or Kallenbach, Curtis Richard, Rockford, Illinois, non-domestic, no
yeah.
zip code.
Yeah,
so,
he said he's got it. Do you know something interesting? I must have got confused somewhere online. I've just pulled out all my certificates, and my original certificate of birth and the certified copy only have capitals at the beginning of each name. And my marriage certificate has my full caps in all my three names.
Huh, interesting.
And you need to stop claiming all three names because that's the beast.
Yeah. Get rid of these flipping names.
Well, I actually disclaimed my marriage name. I go by my, and I've done that formally, I do go by my birth name, but at least I did get rid of my married name.
I never took one. Oh, blimey.
Oh, my goodness.
Uh-oh.
If you want to run over a few minutes, Kurt, if you've got something to finish up with, we can do that. It just means that they won't hear it in the chat room, but they can hear it in the archives because we do want to finish up anyway with just the way we like to finish the show and make some announcements. So if you have something more you need to say, just go ahead.
Oh, no, I'm good to go. And, you know, as usual, I'll be back when you guys want me. And other than that, good night, everybody, but we'll just continue to talk.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, so everybody that's listening live on the browser here at Blog Talk, we'll be chopping off in about 1 minute. You'll find us on the archive, so anything that we talk about after Blog Talk chops us off will be found on the archives. Meanwhile, you'll always find us on Justice Radio Network or the upcoming shows. Just Google Justice Radio Network and you'll find everything that's to do with us, to do with Facebook, Blog Talk, a website, all the podcast, everything. You can find all the YouTube page, everything. So take a look for us and we'll be there. And come back and find us every third Saturday, all being well. Kurt will be here with us. So check in with us. And off we go for the time being. But we'll
thank you very much, Kurt. Wonderful show again. Looking forward to the future with more information coming out and your journey and helping us along with ours. So thank you very much. Thank you, everyone in the chat room, and thank you, everyone, for listening. And we will be up on YouTube.
All right, so we're on the recording still.
Oh, yeah. I thought. Okay.
Do you want to end the episode altogether, or shall we continue? As we were sort of like in the middle of a bit of this paperwork thing, we could finish that and then we'll end the episode.
Whatever you guys want to do.
Well.
I.
Yeah. We were sort of a little bit in the middle of a conversation because we were all sort of like, 90 seconds of crumbs, you know, that Blog Talk was ending. But really, basically, so you didn't seem to think it was much of a that big of a relevance that none of it that wasn't all in caps, whereas my certificate of citizenship, that is all completely in caps.
And it should be. That's, you know, it's a commercial entity in its entirety, but... But I don't worry. I mean, the thing is that, you know, they can do whatever they need to do. I'm not convinced that the capital stuff is even critical. At the beginning, I was, you know, 5 years ago.
Yep.
But first of all, it's not. It has nothing to do with me anyway.
Right.
It isn't my name. It's all caps or upper and lower case. It's not my name. It's actually the title to the afterbirth, and so it really isn't mine to deal with. They created that. I mean, it came through my mother's hand. Now think about that. The title itself, Curtis Richard Kallenbach, came through my mother's hand, and it was attached to the afterbirth, which doesn't have any of my father. Mm-hmm. So the name Curtis Richard Kallenbach is tied to a mama's boy that has no DNA from the father. Why would I want to claim that? I mean, other than the DNA claim. Through the paramount claim,
right.
Divine proportion claim, the last thing I want to do is have anything to do with that mama's boy.
Okay. So with this a change of the document we just were looking at that you sent us, that's one of the, probably after you did the paramount claim for the your own DNA, then you're saying, okay, I don't want this Curtis Kallenbach capital thing, and I'm getting rid of it, and here's what I am certifying is my intention to be. This is my. Is that pretty well it?
Well, yeah. What I've done is right now I have no other way to interface with that system.
Yeah.
Okay. Now look at it. They actually took Kallenbach, comma Curtis Richard, and they tied it. I mean, that's the deposit. And what they gave me to use in their system was Curtis Richard Kallenbach, which is the church's realm, the church's situation.
Yeah.
So they actually took what was mine, Kallenbach, comma Curtis Richard, and they. So what I did when I did this assumed name, both my wife and I both did these. What I did is I actually took their ability to make a claim upon, or even make a claim upon Curtis Richard Kallenbach, because that entity is tied to Kallenbach, comma Curtis Richard. Think about it. So when I took and I went into the county and I claimed Kallenbach, comma Curtis Richard, indirectly I took their ability to make any claims upon my DNA.
Okay.
Yeah, so the paramount claim did it at a common law level where this assumed name certificate, when two more weeks and I'll actually have a document in my hand that says I'm the owner. So two more weeks when it runs in that newspaper, because that's the rules for Illinois.
Okay.
But when I have that assumed name in my hand, there can never be a court case brought against me, because every court case that is tied to Curtis Richard Kallenbach is they're making a claim upon my DNA.
Mm-hmm. And they can't, because you've claimed it.
Now I've even claimed it in the statutory realm. So I claimed it in the common law realm, in the 3D world, with the paramount claim, divine proportion document, and now I turn around and I lay claim to the true name, and it's in the statutory realm. So now I got both the 3D and the 2D realm covered.
Right. Okay.
So I don't need a driver's license, you know, because I'm not doing business. I'm not actually hauling around any property that they're responsible for.
Right. Yeah.
So there's also this matches Kallenbach, comma Curtis Richard actually matches the passport.
So you think the passport's fine, that you can keep going with the passport as it is, you don't have to change it into some other different sort of passport?
I'm going to look into what's called a no-fee passport,
mm-hmm.
because realistically, a commercial passport is for commerce.
Mm.
And the all caps Kallenbach, comma Curtis Richard is still a commercial passport.
Yeah.
Now, there's a no-fee passport, which means, and fee meaning land, or if you think about it, property. A no-fee passport means that nothing was deposited. It didn't require a fee
mm-hmm.
to get the passport. So the no-fee passport is for the living.
Yes. Okay.
So in reality, you should have two passports. You should have the commercial passport for when you're doing business, and you should also, and that's in, you know, a proper one, and you should also have a no-fee passport for yourself.
Okay. And how do you go about getting one of those?
I'm working with Cynthia on that. And I think that you know, that's a really interesting idea, because mm-hmm. for people that know what they're doing, they actually would have two passports.
Mm-hmm.
And finally, step three is withdrawing the Curtis Richard Kallenbach assumed name from the business organization. Now, I know what the business organization is, but most people will not. The business organization is the United States' version of a what's known as a HANS, HANSE.
Mm.
Now, in Europe, I mean, London and England had its own types of trade or mercantile organizations, but in Prussia, in Russia, in Germany, and all those, they had merchant sort of unions called HANSES, the Hanseatic League.
Okay.
The Hanseatic League was a trade organization where merchants, let's say I came from the town or city called Rockford, Illinois, Rockford.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the city of Rockford or the town of Rockford, the township, let's say that it wanted to trade with the community just north of here called Love's Park. If Rockford, the township, had its own little merchant organization where they all collectively got together and said, okay, we're going to send representatives up north to Love's Park, and we're going to deal with their representatives. So all the merchants collectively agree to you know, the terms. Now, when your representatives go up to the Hants up north, think of it as a guild or whatever, a trade organization, it goes up to the Hants representatives just north of town in Love's Park. Now, the Hants representatives of Love's Park would meet with the Hants representatives of Rockford, and they would strike a deal. So the cups and saucers manufacturers of Rockford would be able to trade freely with the nuts and bolts manufacturers of Love's Park. So the Hants, each individual Hants, Rockford's Hants and the Love's Park Hants, the organizations would work, and you know, the trade would flow smoothly between them. Well, the Hants is global. I mean, they're still in existence. We just don't see them. And so the United States actually has its own version of a Hants. And let's say the state of Illinois has all of its merchants. The state of Indiana has all of its merchants. And collectively, they all are under the one collective bargaining unit known as the House of Representatives. And the House of Representatives deals with the global, you know, the German Hants or the English Hants. They deal, so all of these 50 states have collectively come under one singular Hants, and let's just call it the United States. So these are just trade organizations. Each one of us, Curtis Richard Kallenbach, is a merchant. It's a merchant vessel. It's a merchant. And each and all of us have our own merchant vessels that are involved in the local Hants. And so mine originated in Illinois, or the state of Illinois, I should say. And, of course, the state of Illinois is a political subdivision of the United States. Now, when it says it's a political subdivision, they're talking about maybe merchant representation is what they're talking about. So, I mean, Curtis Richard Kallenbach is a merchant vessel that allows me to work within the merchant system. The problem is, it's not mine. And so the creator of that vessel, the United States, is the one that rules over that vessel. So the step three in my idea, my mindset, is to get out from underneath the vessel they created and bring my own vessel in. But as soon as I exit, as soon as I withdraw their vessel from the game, ultimately, I'm out. I'm out. I'm done. Okay. Do I ever have to use the one I created? No, I don't. So once I cancel the vessel, the certificate, like it says in their statutes, when I cancel that vessel, they're going to stamp canceled right across Curtis Richard Kallenbach. They're going to put that afterbirth in its grave. And I will be out. And all that's going to be left is the one I created called Curtis Kallenbach. And whether I choose to ever use it or not is irrelevant. It's not under somebody else's care.
Right. It's your choice.
So I'm free. I'm completely free to do business with the rest of the world forever.
As a living being.
As a living man, yes.
As a living man, yes.
Do you know something interesting? We have these certificates for heaven knows how long, and we don't actually read all of it. I'm looking at my full birth certificate now, and first of all, the first column is number, and it's the number of what, however many people came in the day. And then it says when I were born, so it's got the date of my birth and the hospital I was born in. The next column where my name is, my first two names, Sheila Christine, the title at the top of that says name, if any.
Yes, I said that too. Mine does too.
If any?
If any.
Name, comma, if any.
Yeah. So you didn't have to put a name?
No.
It's interesting.
And then on the back it says that, hold on, let me say what it says on the back, because I was looking at this as well. A name given to a child, whether in baptism or otherwise, before the expiration of 12 months from the date of registration of its birth, may be inserted in column 10, whatever that is, name entered after registration, in the birth register under the procedure provided by Section 13 of the Births and Deaths Registration Act 1953, if the parents or guardians wish to avail themselves of this facility at any time, they must deliver the proper paperwork. So it doesn't say you have to do it at all, even though we're always told you have to register a name.
That's
this says that you didn't
true.
Have to do
mine
it, and even
same.
After 12 months you can. So, like, what? Go figure.
So what would have happened if they hadn't named us?
Yes.
Well, just remember what they're talking about. Are they talking about you?
No.
Look at this. It says parents or guardian, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. And then later down the bottom, you're actually signing as, or somewhere along here, you're signing that you now have the register in legal custody.
Look at the legal term guardian.
Yes, I've seen that before.
Does,
yeah.
Does it say guardian on it?
It says it says parents or guardian.
Oh, mine doesn't.
Look what guardian is. A person lawfully invested with the power and charged with the duty of taking care of the person and managing the property and rights of another person.
Doesn't actually say that, Kurt. It says name and surname of father, and name, surname, and maiden name
of
mother.
Yeah.
It doesn't say guardian on ours.
But this one does say it's a true copy. I do hereby certify this is a true copy of the entry number 326 in the register of births for the said sub-district, and that said register is now legally in my custody. And that was
because my original one is only, you know, we have a choice when you register a baby. You can either have the little one free or you can pay and have the big one. So I've only got the little one, which doesn't give any other information except my name and date.
Hmm.
That's interesting. There's nothing on here that actually says guardian.
I don't know what it is, but there was something you were reading, though, earlier that did say parents or guardian. I'm not sure what it was you were reading.
Yeah, from the back of the certificate where it talks about where I said that you didn't have to put a name in there, it says blah, blah, blah. Hold on a second.
Yeah, if the parents
guardians
wish
to
avail themselves of this facility, this is about doing it, you know, later in the...
After a year, a parent or guardian, if they have baptized the child with a name, they can insert it using the proper form.
Yeah, I don't think that... I think that's just for... That's for misdirection, because we assume the role of guardian over that child, over the afterbirth. I mean, we're the agent of the afterbirth. So
yes.
That's just, again, we don't know it, but that's all we are. We're acting on behalf of the afterbirth.
Yeah.
So I don't really want to do that. So I'd rather do what I need to do for myself and my family, that other creature that they created. But here's the thing that's amazing is think about it as, you know, for like a little sister, you know, a half sister. And that's kind of what they did, is they created a half. I mean, it's easy for me to think of a little brother because it's, you know, it has half my DNA. But if, for you ladies, it would be like having a little half sister from another father. You know, that's not your father. So the only relation, you have the same common mother DNA, but there's another father in place, so you have a different father. Well, that's kind of what they've done, is they're saying that you're still responsible for that child. You are, because you're related to it.
Yes.
And then, of course, you abandon that child, so it falls under the care of the state or the church or whatever. And then because there's fees associated with that care, they're saying, well, you're the blood relative to that thing, so you're the one ultimately responsible. So whenever we find you out in the street, we're going to make sure that we capture a little bit of your income to take care of this thing.
Right. And so we're going to just... So we don't actually claim that back, but we cancel it. That's what we're doing, basically.
The final thing is that the paramount claim / divine proportion is saying my DNA is my DNA, and anything, any other claims have to be erroneous, because otherwise it'd be slavery.
Right.
So that's what that does. In the three. Yeah, that's what that does.
Yeah.
What I've done in step two is actually to claim the true name, Kallenbach, Curtis Richard, which takes their ability to make a legal claim upon anything relative to that. And finally, step three is to take that assumed name, Curtis Richard Kallenbach, in all of its forms, you know, in all of its forms, and to basically say, I'm from that name, from the use of that name, and I'd like my deposit back.
And the deposit was the DNA originally.
The deposit was ultimately was the Kallenbach, Curtis Richard.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah, we never see that. We don't know that it exists. But on the internal documents, on everything they're using, that's our true name. So when we're in a court situation, we're claiming to be Curtis Richard Kallenbach, that's really not true. So I don't know who the hell I am. You know,
There's the other words, Jerry, in your birth certificate under section 7. It says signature, description, and residence of informant. That's that word where they've used informant instead of mother and father. Yeah.
You know what the word information is? Information, the word means accusation. So when somebody signs that document as informant or informer, they're signing it in an accusatory fashion. It becomes what's known as a libel.
Okay.
Yes.
In this instance, the informant was my father.
Well.
Yeah, it was my father as well.
Really?
Mm. Yes, my mother didn't sign it.
And residence of informant, MG Jones' father and his address.
Yeah,
Interesting, because now the father's actually kind of making a true... Right. A true claim, saying that's not my child. He's informing. He's accusing. He's making an accusation, and he's pointing a finger saying, this is not mine. And, of course, the ecclesia, in fact, let me see where the ecclesia looks at this as a libel, L-I-B-E-L, and let me see if I can find that word real quick, because it's important for people to know that accusation, that information, the key word is information. That information is an accusation. And is an accusation, and the church sees it as an accusation, and you need to deny it. Let me see what libel. Here it is, libel. Yeah, libel.
My father actually is no longer here, so I don't know how that.
No, neither is mine.
I don't know how that affects anything.
The fact that he's not here.
He's deceased. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, the thing is that the signature. The signature is prima facie evidence that the child that he's accusing, it still exists. The signature is still saying that that's not my child. And he's talking about the afterbirth, by the way, not you. He's talking about the afterbirth.
Right.
Here it is, article. In English ecclesiastical law, a complaint exhibited in the ecclesiastical court by way of libel. The different parts of a libel, responsive allegation or counter-allegation in the ecclesiastical courts. So when there's an accusation, when there's a libel, when they're saying that character is a bastard child, that's what they're saying. That is not mine. That's an illegitimate child. Of course, illegitimacy is a real was really nasty, you know. Many generations ago, it's not so nasty now, but is there really, let's think about this. They have us using terms like illegitimate or bastard. Mm-hmm. In nature, are there any such things?
Yeah, no.
No, there isn't. It's another construct of our mind that all children are wonderful, you know, and they all have fathers.
Yeah.
Every child out there has a father.
Yeah, absolutely.
So in nature, there isn't any of that stuff. And so we've gotten so far away from the truth of the matter, and that's kind of where that's my hope, is that we get our heads out of our behinds and start thinking clearly again and not constructively. I mean, objectivity is reality.
How is your birth certificate different to ours, Kurt?
Because you seem to
be surprised by some things that I've said on here. Like,
yeah.
I've never noticed that before, name, if any. That's really weird.
Yeah.
Let me see if I have one available.
Yeah, is yours kind of long and narrow, Sheila?
Yes, that's a 4-1.
And
yeah.
It's kind of red printing on it.
It's all red except where it's typed in.
Yeah. It's handwritten.
Everything is typed on this because
mine's all
copy. Yeah. It's handwritten on my little original one.
Oh, that's my little original
copy. It's typed in. Yeah.
Okay, yeah, my certified copy's typed in. Yes.
Yeah.
But interesting enough, they both at the bottom say this is a true certified true copy.
Yeah, and didn't I cover true copy?
Yes,
yeah,
you did somewhere. I remember your true copy and all of that. Yeah, I do remember.
Okay, so I have a certificate of live birth here.
No, it's a different thing. A certificate of live birth and a birth certificate is two different things as far as I've heard.
And I have not seen a birth certificate for a long time.
Hmm.
So I don't know. I mean, I could order a birth certificate, I think, from Illinois. I think and it might even be called a birth certificate.
Hmm.
Okay.
These are the ones that we were given as, you know, like our parents had got when we were born and kept them. We were a little kind of a tin box and everything with all the important papers were in there. And then eventually we were all sort of old enough and they're like, right, you can have it now. My mum sent it to me. She's like, here, you can take it. Like I say, it looks like 100 years old. It's so kind of faded and watermarked and goodness knows what.
What's interesting about this Winnebago County, Illinois certificate of live birth is on this certificate, it says child's name, Curtis Richard Kallenbach, you know, first, middle, last. But at the bottom where it was notarized, it actually says, I hereby certify that the attached is a true and correct copy of the birth record of Curtis Richard Kallenbach. And that's all caps.
Jerry, so, do something. Your original little birth certificate.
Yes.
Hold it up to the light and look at that watermark. The watermark actually says copy.
Yes, it does.
It says copy.
Yeah.
In the watermark.
Really?
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, and remember, I think we covered genuine, original, and copy last time as well.
Yes, we did.
Yeah.
This isn't an original at all. And it doesn't say it's a copy.
It just says it's a true copy. It says it's a true copy down the bottom. IEJW door, registrar of birth and death.
But look at your original one, the free one. That doesn't say it's a certified copy because it is the original one, certificate of birth. And there's a watermark there that says copy.
Yeah.
Now that's a bit intriguing.
And at the top it says certified copy in red writing. Doesn't say nowhere does it say anything to do with an original. It all says it's a copy. Certified copy of an entry of birth. An entry of birth. It's not even a certificate.
Well, you're looking at the big one, aren't you? The little one that's given to you that's supposed to be the original where it's handwritten and signed handwritten.
Yeah.
That's the one that says certificate of birth, but if you hold it up to the light, there's a watermark that says copy.
Yes.
And nowhere on the writing, anywhere, does it say it's a copy, except on that watermark.
Well, mine says a certified copy at the top.
That's weird. Mine doesn't say that.
Yeah, it does. It's a certified copy of an entry of birth. And at the bottom, it goes on as saying that the registrar... hereby certified this is a true copy of the entry number.
Isn't this weird? You know, it must be something to do with the difference in our years because because this is an original. Nowhere does it mention anything about copy except in the watermark. So they obviously changed the rules as they went along.
You mean the watermark actually says copy?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. The watermark that this certificate is printed
on. Mine says copy too if you look under the
and light. These are handwritten?
Yes, mine's a handwritten one. It doesn't say anything about copy anywhere else. It's a proper certificate copy. And it says certificate of birth. And it's all handwritten.
I can't read it. Give me a copy if it's handwritten.
Certified
copy.
It's
written.
Mine says certified copy in the watermark, Sheila.
Yeah, well,
mine writing a certified copy at the top.
Yeah, mine doesn't say that at all.
Yeah, see, it's different.
I was born like a few years before you. They must have changed the rules when they got to you.
61.
Yeah, mine's 1950.
All this bloody paper. Do you know what? I'm ready for all this to be irrelevant. All this language, all this flipping bullshit. It's just all just such, isn't it? I mean, like, you've done such a detective job, Kurt, with this, and it's fantastic. But at the end of the day, just stop it, everyone. Let's make a big bonfire, throw all the paper in it, and you can all bugger off, take responsibility of yourselves, and let's just get on with our lives.
And that's the answer. And that is the answer. The answer is, in the here and now, dealing with truth, and you know what? Again, nature, we can love each other, and we can do whatever we want to do to help each other, but what they've done is they've created one giant global communist society where we are forced.
Yeah.
Everything is taken from us, and then it's distributed amongst us.
Yeah.
We don't have any say over our lives at all, not even a little bit.
You have to do that, and if you don't do this, you can't have that, and if you don't do that, you can't have this, and if you don't do this, we'll throw you in jail, and all that sort of flipping malarkey. It's getting very boring, isn't it?
Maybe
all of this
come out. Do you know?
What?
When did birth certificates?
Well, they were created a long time ago. I know that they used them for the African slaves. They were called property. They were property certificates at the time, but
There was something. I'll have to go and find the information. I think if my memory serves me right, it was around the 40s that they decided that everybody should have birth certificate. It's
1933 in the U.S. It was the Securities and Exchange Commission came out with the in 1933 and 34. Those 2 years. Now think about those words: securities and exchange. What exactly did we do? We exchanged, just like Pink Floyd says, we exchanged our true lives for something entirely different. We've exchanged ourselves for a graven image, an idol that we can use in place of money, and it is our, it's us. Mm. It's our labor.
Yeah. With the value.
It's our pledge or our promise.
On the other side,
we're the
of
Borg.
The moon. Pink Floyd on the other side of the moon.
Yeah.
The dark side of the moon.
Hey, you know what's really interesting? There, when the divine female and the divine male are finally brought back together, they're no longer divorced. Do you know what the symbol looks like?
No, tell us.
Can you envision a like a quarter moon with a star?
Oh yeah.
Have you ever seen it anywhere?
Oh yeah.
Yeah, so you got this quarter moon or this half moon, and in its crescent, in its concave side, is the star. The star is the male, it's the Heavenly Father, and the moon, the lune, L-U-N-E, which is where two circles intersect or overlap, when you take the one circle and the Vesica Pisces away from it, it leaves a crescent. And then, of course, the crescent is the mother, the lune, and then the star is the both the father and the child mixed together. So you got this crescent moon and the star inside its convex area. That it looks, it's a beautiful symbol, but it's I believe it's the symbol of what is it, the Muslims? Do they use it?
Yeah, but it's also a country that's got something like that.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm going to Google it right now because...
It's on a map, on a flag.
If you just Google moon and star symbol...
Is it not Russian?
Symbol. Yeah, there it is right there. And there's all kinds of... You can... There,
oh,
it's beautiful.
It's Turkey, yeah.
Is it Turkey?
Yeah.
And you know what? If you look into the history of Turkey, if you look into the history of Turkey, it'll probably blow your mind. But the moon, the moon and the star is. Go ahead.
Symbols of Islam.
And that's where they've just found this real Bible.
Okay,
you got to be kidding.
No, I'll have to find that link and send it to you somewhere.
I'll find
it somewhere.
Well, that's what they're going to find. You're going to find all this stuff is actually attached. And what they've done is we have been divorced. Again, the divine male and divine female are actually legally considered divorced. So we're not whole.
Well, have you,
and so
have
the,
you looked at what the Google's pulled up on this? There's something here. The website is Above Top Secret, and the title is Star and Crescent Moon Symbol of Satan.
Yeah, I saw that one.
Wow.
Star and crescent moon symbol of Satan, page one.
Ooh. Let me see that.
It's abovetopsecret.com.
Oh, it is?
The symbol of the crescent moon and star of Venus does not represent Islam. Let me get to the page. Have you got the page open, Jerry?
I think it is. Yes, the symbol and crescent moon of Star of Venus does not represent Islam. It's a cult imagery. It is a cult imagery, and it is ubiquitous.
Whose web page is this? Jesse Ventura.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, there's a big picture of him on the side.
Is
there.
That who? I don't know him, you see. I see the person.
Oh, you don't? Oh, right, okay.
I don't know him.
You know him, Kurt, yeah?
I've heard of him, but I haven't
looked at. Yeah, I'm not really sure who he's working for.
No, I'm not either. He's a bit of a... Well, I think he's just working for himself most of the time, but it's interesting, yeah.
Okay, so it says it's Satan. But again, the moon symbolizes sin, or the concept of sin, which only means moon. So...
That's another thing as well, because it says here, and I know that's the other place I've seen it. It says, hidden in plain sight, it conspicuously appears on the flags of the communist dictatorships. I think that's where we're remembering it from.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. What we saw is a sickle,
yes,
which is actually
Yes.
Well, wow. See, that's that's the thing is when what they do is they have the body. The body is the lunae, or you know what I mean? If you think of the star in it, in heaven, and then you think of the body, have either of you seen the movie Elysium?
No, I don't know. That escapes me. I've seen most movies.
It's a it's Matt Damon. It's an interesting movie because if you Google it and you see the picture of it, you'll actually see where the wealthy, the super wealthy or the super elite are living off planet, but the thing they're living on is actually a five-pointed star off Mother Earth. So you got this five-pointed star for the elite out in space, in the heavens, and then you have all the garbage junk, you know, the struggling, the rest of the planet down there on Mother Earth. So you have the lunae or the Mother Earth, the mother, the crescent moon, and then you have the star, the Heavenly Father, out there off planet, extraterrestrial, off planet. You know what I mean? That's an interesting. When I drew this, the divine proportion, I don't know, maybe 3 or 4 months ago, I drew it with the star, the five-pointed star, in the segment, the one, and of course the other side, the afterbirth side, the .666, is where the lunae is, the Mother Earth. So when you know what, when people talk about the star and the crescent, what they're talking about is the paganistic concept of the duality of the divine male and the divine female coming together. So it's pagan. It's paganistic. And that's what scares the people when they start talking about Satan. Anytime anybody uses the word Satan, you already know their belief system.
I'm going to send this link to you. I've just found it. 1,500-year-old Syriac Bible found in Ankara, Turkey.
Well,
and it says the Vatican Union shock. Well, I don't know about that, but I'll put the link in here for you.
So guess who would use the term Satan? The man in the box.
Yep.
The man in the box. The man in the box is going to use terms that identify Satan because it's a Christianity-based concept. I don't understand. I don't know what Satan is. Is it good? Is it bad? I don't know. Because I Christianity escapes me. I'm not involved in a belief system that forces me to believe that there's I know there's ugly out there. Some people would call it evil. You know, but I believe in the you know, I think man is
evil is authority.
I think man is inherently good.
Some people actually equate Satan to Saturn.
To Saturn?
Saturn, yeah.
Really? What has Saturn ever done to you?
Well, I could go and give you a whole... I could be here 2 hours talking about all the planets and my feeling about them, but that's another... that's another whole show, yeah. We could start with the moon and go on from there.
Yeah.
And every time they think we're going off the path, they just paint another planet in, but that's by the by. Jordan Maxwell has some very interesting information on Saturn. He's a Bible scholar. Yeah.
Well, belief systems. The mechanics of the universe are that's what they are. I mean, you know, there's a balance going on or an equilibrium, and you know, realistically, what do I know? And when it comes right down to it, what do I know but what's right in front of me?
Exactly.
And when I see somebody doing something that probably isn't a good thing, I have a couple of options. You know, I can do nothing or I can do something.
Mm-hmm.
And right now, everybody is doing nothing.
Everybody's not doing nothing.
Well, I mean
you are stepping up.
The majority is doing nothing.
Well, there's 144,000 of us somewhere.
I've seen that number before.
Honestly, like we could talk. It's like, you know, the guests that we've been having on our shows lately, we could sit and talk for a week, and every time we talk about something, it leads us onto another path of research. So, you know, I just want to say thank you so much, Kurt. I love you to bits, and thank you for being part of us.
You guys
doing is brilliant.
you guys make everything I do worthwhile, and that's the beauty, is I am blessed, man, and I surround myself with you guys, seriously.
Yeah. Well, so, well, you are us, and we are you.
We're all each other.
Yeah.
We're all on the
All right,
same
are we
bar.
Done?
Yeah, I think we're,
yeah,
done.
We're done.
I'm playing the outro. I think we've really done well, haven't we?
And we'll give you our good old British. Goodbye, mate.
Goodbye.
Talk to you next time.
Bye.
Thanks, Kurt.
Thank
Bye.
You.
Brilliant.
Bye, Jerry.
Good night. Bye-bye. Cheerio.
See you later, alligator.
See you in a while. Fuck it all.
I'm so happy.
Jolly good show.
Flipping Nora.
Flipping Nora. Flipping that.
I think people that come on our show don't know what they've let themselves
into.
A couple of weirdos.
We just keep throwing a spanner in the works, and that'll just keep them all going. And then they get the knickers in a knot, so then they'll run away. On Just Us Radio Network for our shows Inflowment, Unity in Community, Numbers in Time, The Indigenous People's Voice, One Point of View, Walking the Talk with Kurt, and the People's Round Table. Check out our website for information about upcoming shows. Just ask Google to find Just Us Radio Network, and you will find links to our website and to our blog talk and Facebook pages, as well as to our podcast, where you can subscribe for automatic downloads.